chairman of the Lloyd College Young Americans for Freedom chapter here. Today we have the distinct honor of listening to Professor Harvey Mansfield, the William R. Cannon Jr. Professor of Government at Harvard University. Mr. Mansfield is the author of more than a dozen books, including celebrated translations of Machiavelli's Prince, Discourses in Florentine Histories, as well as with the aid of his wife, Tocqueville's Democracy in America. In 2006, Mansfield published his book, Manliness, and that famous or infamous book will be the topic of his discussion here tonight. Before moving on to that, however, I'd like to first acknowledge an America's Foundation, in particular Pat Coyle, with whom I work to organize this. Here on campus, I'd like to thank our advisor, Rob LaFleur, as well as Ann Davies, Scott Behrman, and Andras Poros-Kazai for writing letters of encouragement to make this happen. And so now I turn the stage over to Mr. Mansfield.
Thumbs down! Yeah, unsubscribe.
Thank you very much, Andrew. Friends in the light, new friends that I've encountered this morning. So I want to talk about manliness. These are a few words from, essentially based on my book, which came out of that name, which came out in 2006. And I begin from the gender-neutral society, which I've been in the process of constructing. The gender-neutral society is a society in which sex is not an issue. In this society, sex does not decide, or in the best case, does not affect your duties, your rights, and your place. This is a society of choice in which the old sex roles no longer exist. Manliness is still around, and we still find it attractive. What do we like about it? Two things, I would say, for a start. The confidence of manly men and their ability to command. The confidence of a manly man gives him independence of others. He is not always asking for help or directions or instructions. For it is out of manliness that men do not like to ask for directions when lost. The manly man is in control when control is difficult or contested, in a situation of risk. He knows his job and he stands fast in that knowledge. If he doesn't really know his job, his confidence is false and he's just boasting. If he knows it but lets himself be pushed around, he's also not really confident, he merely as the basis for confidence. The first case of boasting is a manly excess. The second is a defect of manliness. For some reason, manliness includes, or is hospitable to, too much manliness. But it emphatically rejects a person who has too little of it. Perhaps it is because a manly man wants his manliness to be visible. So he is often portrayed in novels and movies or wherever, an exaggeration. Even not too much manliness is also a defect and can have disastrous consequences. The independence of a manly man would keep him from getting involved with other people. He would be aloof, satisfied with himself, and none too interested in other people's problems. At the least, he would wait to intervene until he is called upon to do so. But that degree of independence is in tension with the other manly element, the ability to command. The manly man is good at getting things done, and one reason is that he's good at ordering people to get them done. In politics and in other political situations, he willingly takes responsibility when others hang back. He not only stands fast, but also steps up to do what is required. In private life, in the family, this ability makes him protective of his wife and children because they are weaker. Being protective, as opposed to nurturing, is a manly form of responsibility in private life, analogous to getting into politics in public life. In both, there is an easy assumption of authority.
Oh my fucking God. Who paid you?
Take authority.
Who paid you? Who signed your check?
The need for authority in general
with their own particular authority.
Who fucking made you come here?
To the extent that all of us recognize the need for authority, whether emergency or every day, we are attracted to those who seem to radiate authority and thus inspire confidence. Nor is it clear that women want to do away with manliness in a more moderate form with the gentleman. It is for them, I suspect, still something of a treat to be in the company of a man who behaves like a gentleman. Women are quite expert in the interpretation of small courtesies, and they're still in the habit of awarding points to men who offer them, especially in the early stages of acquaintance. Women are still very observant, more so than men. And you, as a man, can be sure that instead of just being themselves, they are looking at you to see what you are doing for them.
Yeah, right.
Are you showing interest? And if so, how? Moreover, precisely in times of greater sexual freedom, it is good to be with someone you, as a woman, can trust. A gentleman is a man who is gentle out of policy, not weakness, so that he can be depended upon not to snarl at or attack a woman when he has the advantage or feels threatened. It can be delightful, of course, to be surprised as long as one is pleasantly surprised. With a gentleman, you can hope or even expect that most of the surprises will be that sort. Now, so far, I've been talking about the good side of manliness. But is there reason to doubt that manliness is good? Let us look at two well-known authors who show their doubt of manliness in two well-known writings. First, recall the incident in the first chapter of Tom Sawyer between Tom and the new boy in town. The new boy is citified, comes from the city, and Tom cannot abide him. It is a dispute over nothing, arising merely for the sake of superiority. A meaningless argument, vain boasting on both sides, a line drawn in the dust, the dare to step over it, step accepted, a scuffle followed by recriminations and threats. It's not hard to guess that this is Mark Twain's picture of manliness done in childish caricature. He seems to say that manliness is childish, only perhaps not so funny, and its irrationality not so obvious or so innocent when assumed by adult males. In the adult version, the scuffle is a war. Twain's critique, though this is just a glimpse of a wonderful book, resembles a woman's disdain for men's foolish daring. Another view of manliness can be found in Shakespeare's Julius Caesar. At the end, in Mark Antony's tribute to Brutus, the speech ends, quote, "His life was gentle, and the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man." What man would not like to hear this said of him? Of course, Brutus has just lost the battle and has died by his own hand. So any tribute from nature would be a kind of consolation in defeat. Indeed, we perhaps especially reserve tributes to manliness for noble losers. Nothing more substantial is left then. But we human beings have to make the tributes. Nature, unfortunately, does not stand up and speak for itself, as Antony seems to wish. Antony, a man, has to speak up for a man and say how perfect he was. But actually, it's Shakespeare, speaking through Antony, who speaks for nature. Poets must assert the dignity and excellence of man against nature, because nature on its own preserves no memory of the best human beings. It is only through Shakespeare and other poets, aided by historians, that we know of Brutus. Only through Homer that we know of Achilles. Manly men like Antony have a tendency to believe that manliness speaks for itself, as if manliness were a natural perfection that all can recognize implicitly, that nature makes perfectly obvious. In Shakespeare's view, again, nothing but a glimpse of one speech, Manliness looks better than it does in a scene from Tom Sawyer. Since it serves the function of defending us against tyrants like Julius Caesar, it is not merely foolish. But manly men tend to exaggerate the naturalness of their behavior, and they forget the need for poets who are not men of action. Manliness is biased in favor of action. That is a severe criticism when you come to think about it. One could even say that thinking is by itself a challenge to the superiority of manliness. So let's study, look at manliness from several viewpoints, and I want to take first the political meaning. Manliness is an individual quality that causes a human being to come forth and stand up for something, make an issue of it. It is like the young lady who just left. It is a quality held by private persons that call them forth into public, hence into politics. In the past, such persons have been predominantly, though not exclusively, males. And it is, of course, no accident that those who possess a quality that propels them into politics end up as the rulers. Once in politics, they do not modestly depart after the occasion of their entry has passed. What starts out as a protest against some injustice easily crosses over into assertion on behalf of a cause, and then into defense of those now ruling having succeeded in their protest. Manliness seems to be a mixture of defensiveness and assertiveness. Manly types defend their turf, as we've been taught to say by the sociobiologists. They rightly connect manliness to the behavior of other mammals, who first create their own turf, marking out its boundaries with any convenient means, and then defend it. Tom Sawyer very decently drew a line in the dust with his bare toe. The analogy to animals obviously suggests something animal in manliness, which suggests other things. What is animal in human beings may be functional, but it is not rational or not fully rational. And if it is part of our biological nature, it is also deeply ingrained. But of course, manliness is specifically human as well. Manly men defend not their turf, but their country, which stands for something. Manliness is best shown in war, in the defense of one's country at its most difficult and dangerous.
In Greek,
the word for manliness, Andrea, is also the word for courage. Aristotle says that courage is best shown in battle. The issue raised over women in the military concerns the sovereign claim of manliness as the title to rule. For if women can fight as well as men, why can they not govern as well and as deserved? Here's a line of thinking that makes war or conflict central to politics, and manliness is central to the inspiration of both. It has behind it not only the evidence not only of males ruling over all societies at almost all times, but also male preponderance in crime and in the prison population. For good and for ill, males, apparently impelled by their manliness, have dominated all politics we know of, up to now. Is there something inevitable about this, from which we are free to depart? One reason to doubt the future of manliness is that manliness seems undemocratic, while the direction of history in America and elsewhere seems to be toward ever more democracy. To put oneself forward, even in behalf of someone else or a higher cause, seems to require a display of ego. The manly man will take it personally if you do not pay attention to what he says. But a display of ego implies that one is not satisfied with what satisfies most people. It is, at base, an aristocratic impulse. Women, having less ego in the popular sense of willingness to display it, are more democratic than men, as Aristophanes shows in his play, The Congresswomen. As war regimes become democratic, and existing democracies become more democratic, all should benefit from the fact that democracies do not fight one another, perhaps then manliness would be less in demand. At the end of history, when all states are democratic and peaceful. This is what William James feared in his famous essay on the moral equivalent of war, an essay he wrote in 1911, 3 years before World War I broke out. The moral equivalent of war. The moral equivalent is manliness. And James thought it so valuable that it ought to be generated artificially now that survival no longer makes it necessary. Yet in contrast to such fears, based on a supposed incompatibility of manliness and democracy, there is a democratic manliness, as explained by Tocqueville. In democracies, he said, a manly frankness prevails, an open and fearless stance of man to man, in which all or all males are equal. A man does not have to hide his feelings as he does in an aristocracy, where he is always living in the presence of superiors and inferiors. When Americans travel today, they often judge the men they meet as unmanly in comparison with American men. Their manners seem precious to us, perhaps because they maintain a certain reserve toward others that is a vestige of the aristocratic past of their societies. Such men can be sexy. Think of Marcello Mastroianni or John Belmondo from an older generation, or Leonardo DiCaprio from ours. But sexy is not the same thing as manly. It is a question, however, whether the sensitive male is either sexy or manly, though he is intended to be very democratic. Will modern women be attracted to the kind of man who is sensitive to them and perhaps a little too eager to please? In sum, manliness, as we've noted, has been at the core of politics. What will happen when the gender gap is closed and politics is feminized or made available to women on an equal basis? Either manliness must be transformed into a sexless quality, or its relevance must be reduced if it cannot be eliminated altogether. And a second question, how are manliness and democracy related? Should democracy regard manliness as an enemy because it is the privilege of one sex? Or does democracy require and tend to produce a certain manliness? The social meaning of manliness recovers another set of questions. Since I was just speaking of sex, we may begin from sexual man, a private aspect of manliness that implies the social. Sexually, a man must perform. That a woman need not. The performance is, of course, more a matter of desire than choice. But still, there is something theatrical about male sex that easily reminds us of showing off. Whereas brute animals show off for the purpose of display, which has a biological function, human ones show off in the more metaphorical sense of making a drama of yourself. I've already mentioned the use that poets make of manly men and the criticism with which philosophers respond. This duel between poetry and philosophy is featured in Plato's Republic, which could be described as a debate on the value of manliness. To make a drama of yourself is to make a federal case of your private troubles, to invest them with a universal or cosmic significance, as did Achilles when Agamemnon stole his girlfriend. Manly men bring cases of injustice to the attention of society, or the gods, but they do tend to exaggerate. Or on the contrary, is it not the case that truly manly men do not complain, but suffer without complaint? But they are not humble. They are at their best when championing the deserving cause of someone weaker than they are. But they do not allow themselves to be insulted. They have a strong sense of honor. Though they do not complain, they make it clear that they are not complaining. You could even say that they boast of not complaining, or that they boast of not boasting. Manly men make assertions, and then they make good on them, or fail nobly. Now we are back to
that's just failure.
Another social aspect of manliness is its attitude toward women. Here, the main feminist criticism of manliness enters. Is male chauvinism necessary to manliness?
No.
It certainly seems that manly men have had the habit of distinguishing themselves from the unmanly, whom they frequently call effeminate. We do not simply let others make the distinctions, but seem to feel the need to insist on it themselves. Theodore Roosevelt never praised manly deeds without also scorning weak men's and mollycoddles and shirk them. Now, is this habit necessary to manliness, or can it be dispensed with as obsolete and unworthy? Is it possible to remove the exclusivity of manliness that the feminists indict and still get the same oomph? The energy of manliness seems to go with its eagerness to pass judgment, adverse judgment, on others. So if manliness is made sexless, so too must chauvinism. Yet manliness, besides condemning effeminacy, offers gallantry to women. What is the true nature of gallantry? Is it really an admission of a superiority of women, as it appears to be? Or is it fundamentally insincere, because it always contains an element of disdain? A man who opens the door for a woman makes a show of being stronger than she, you could say. And the philosopher Kant did say it. But on the other hand, the woman does go first. And manly men are often those most easily deceived by women. Such was the reputation of the Spartans, who were the most manly Greeks. Manly men are romantic about women. Unmanly men are sensitive. Which is better? Which is better for women? That brings us to sex roles. The feature of all previous societies that the gender-neutral society finds most objectionable. Even more than patriarchy, the rule of men, the belief that nature has defined different social roles for men and women is now found insulting to women. The belief has now largely been abandoned in favor of the new notion of choice. Choice in a new expanded sense applies not only to the decision to have an abortion, but also to the range of choices that men used to have. A woman today has the choice of every occupation that used to be reserved for men, plus women's roles. The latter are now transformed because women choose them rather than being condemned to them. Looking at men's roles, one wonders what happens when men no longer have the duties that used to go with being a man. Choice for women is inevitably choice for men, too, and perhaps more for them than for women. If women find it easier to love their children than men do, then women's duties toward children are less dutiful, more supported by inclination than men's duties. In the traditional view, the performance of men's duties is aided by another feature of manliness, the desire to protect and support one's family. To be a man means to be able to support one's dependents, not merely oneself alone. But the modern woman, above all, does not want to be a dependent. She has perhaps not reflected on what her independence does to the manliness of men. It might seem to make them more selfish. And whether the protection she gladly gives without will be replaced by sensitivity or by neglect. The statistics on male abandonment of their children in our day are not heartwarming. The noun parent has always existed, but only recently has the verb to parent been created. Previously, the work that verb includes was done separately in two verbs, to father and to mother. Can the separation between father and mother be overcome so that parenting, which is neither, becomes a reality?
Wow.
Father and mother are the fundamental roles that undergird the sexual difference in occupations. If you can get rid of that difference in the role, then all other differences will disappear too. One could say that the authoritative father and the loving mother correspond to the public and private spheres as wholes, the one where aggression is paramount the other where peering is the theme. Abolition of sexual roles might then be expected to produce a mixing of public, understood broadly as the wider world, and private, the realm of your familiars. Is this possible and desirable? We now presuppose, more or less, that men and women are exchangeable. Are we forgetting about how they are complementary? According to the general neutral society, any traditional notion that the sexes complement each other serves merely to justify the inferiority of women. Complementarity, if it really takes place, is a kind of equality in which each sex is superior in its place. But when you are sure that the overall superiority has been men's, and that women have been the second sex, which is the title of Simone de Beauvoir's famous book, then to have equality, you must go for the exchangeability of the sexes. Yet there seems to be some truth in the complementarity, say, of aggression and caring, in hard and soft temperaments. One is to accomplish, and the other is to preserve. And in between is neither. Of course, there are hard women and soft men, but the idea of choice must depend on there being no natural preponderance of one quality or the other in men and women. The logic of choice leads to the ideal of perfect flexibility, in which nothing external determines or even influences our choice. That ideal of freedom is very like the final stage of communism that Karl Marx sketched so briefly, in which the division of labor has been done away with. Underneath the question of roles is the question of nature. Do men and women have different natures that justify different social roles, even different fates, as Toffel said? Or are these so-called natures actually socially constructed?
Yes.
Social construction is a crucial element in the argument supporting the gender-neutral society, because that idea enables women to escape the prison of nature. Once women see that their roles have been made for them, not permanently by nature, but artificially by society, they realize that what was made by humans can be unmade and remade by humans. The difficulty is that one woman cannot do this by herself. She needs the help of society, perhaps in the form of a women's movement. Will she then become a prisoner of society, if not nature? Surely the range of choice open to women now is greatly enlarged, but this success makes the remaining restrictions on choice harder to tolerate. Manliness is a word not much heard these days. But stereotype is a word at large in our speech.
You said it like 70 times. Dude.
Manliness, in fact, is not much heard because it is considered to be a traditional stereotype, a construction of folklore or alleged common sense. What is the manliness stereotype? The definition of manliness I have given, confidence in the face of risk, is composed of a number of ingredients. These are qualities thought to belong to men. Some apply to all men, others only to certain men, mainly men. All are thought to be more or less characteristic of men, not equally true of every man. These qualities, ingredients of manliness, make manliness specifically male. Without them, confidence could be as well be womanly. And there is womanly confidence. These qualities are, however, typically contrasted to womanly qualities so that the stereotypes come in pairs. Stereotypes are about differences, and differences are more pronounced in contrast. Stereotypes give women an excuse for not being manly.
Wait a minute, what?
At the same time, of course, they take away any excuse for a man who is unmanly. Manliness is an exclusion of women, but a reproach to men, to unmanly men. The basic stereotype is surely that men are aggressive, women are caring. This is the first one you would think of, and perhaps also the basis of the others. That men are promiscuous in sex, women faithful, or at least unadventurous, follows from the basic stereotype. So too do the beliefs that men are hard, women soft, men assertive, women sensitive, men seek risk, women security, men are frank, women are indirect, men take the lead, women seek company, men don't cry, women do, men are aloof, women sympathetic, men are cold, women warm, men boast and show off, women are modest, men are forceful, women persuasive or seductive,
men talk loud,
women are quiet, men are laconic, women are loquacious, men are stoic, women complain. It's also said that men are rational, women emotional. One can easily imagine a sexist male saying that in exasperation to or about a woman. A more refined version of this pairing might say that men are abstract, idealistic. Women are empirical and realistic. How is that related to the basic stereotype of aggression and pairing? One might suggest that men use their reason to yearn beyond and to seek to abstract from the present situation, while women use their reason to study and make the best of the present. Thus, both men and women have both reason and emotion, but differently. Let me finish with some words on courage. Courage is not solely for men, but it is mainly for men. As I said, the Greek word for courage, Andrea, comes from the he-man, and also means manliness. The Greek philosopher Aristotle was, however, critical of the implication in his language that courage was for men only. He said something not so definite. He said, men find it easier to be courageous than women, and women find it easier to be moderate than men. We all know of courageous women unafraid to risk their lives in defense of a principle. Ayaan Hirsi Ali, for example. We know of many more women who would defend their children with their lives, the sort of action that made Rudyard Kipling say that, quote, the female of the species is more deadly than the male. And we know of women who can rise to the occasion, overcoming their ordinary characters, like Grace Kelly in the film High Noon, pacifist who shoots an outlaw who is about to shoot her man. Aristotle makes this remark in the Politics. But do women, in fact, have more tender natures than men, making them less apt for courage? It's not a question that would have been raised as a public issue before our time. Previously, it was taken for granted that men and women were different, especially regarding courage. The same Aristotle who implicitly demanded courage of women also said that courage was especially to be found in battle. One gets the red badge of courage then.
Oh, I hate that one.
In war. And women were not thought to be cut out for war.
But the dude's a coward.
To kill women in war was considered barbaric because women were by nature non-combatants. Our thinking today offers two objections to this universal verdict of common sense. And the first comes from feminism, particularly the feminism that began with Simone de Beauvoir's Second Sex, which denies any and all sex differences in human nature. And the second is in our social science, which is hostile to common sense and unwelcoming to natural inclinations of any sort. Since de Beauvoir's book, feminism has been committed to the position that the sexes are not essentially different. To deny this, or to imply that it is wrong, is to be guilty of essentialism, a grave sin in both reason and morality. Essentialism makes reason rigid and morality judgmental. It turns one into a bully, hiding behind the excuse that God or nature made things the way they are, leaving men with no choice but to discriminate against women. Of course, feminism in its latest phase is less radical than the de Beauvoir model. And also, I have to say, less interesting. Feminism has succeeded in making its point that women should be excluded from nothing. And so most women think that it's time for détente between the sexes. They find they are attracted to men after all, even to manly men. And they often hesitate or refuse to call themselves feminists. In theory, they are still very reluctant to admit that women are less capable than men in any regard, for they see no reason to make unilateral concessions that may turn out to their disadvantage. Since some women may want to join the military, and though most women would not follow them, they would not prevent them. In practice today, most women, especially younger ones, yield somewhat, admitting, if only by implication, that natural sex differences do exist. They are willing to let men be men, subject to the age-old criticism that today's women have begun to indulge in once again. This criticism is not the attack on the chauvinism of the entire male sex, characteristic of radical feminism, but the polishing of morals and manners that a woman reserves for her man. For her man has reappeared. This is a sign that women are, if only in practice, ready to admit, again by implication, that they don't mind counting on, which means depending on, men. For their part, men have largely dropped any objections to having women at work with them. They have no strong objection to women in the military. If some women want opportunity for courage, they think, let them have it. Most women in the military are not in combat units, and the combat efficiency of American